and improving rhythm. Okay, and one of the big bugbears, that's management speak. There's a guy in my office, and he went on a management course, and he came back with all these different terms that drives everybody nuts. And there's a can I use a bad word for a minute?
Yes.
I came across a site called Bullshit Bingo. And it's where you print out little cards with all these little, you know, drilling down and moving forward. And you pass them out to people in the meeting. And they tick them off as the manager's going to, and then you jump up and say, bullshit! So anyway, a bugbear of mine. Something that I try and talk about when I'm doing banjo workshops is the notion of trying to get away from the very staccato machine gun kind of digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga-digga style of banjo. Now, a large aspect of that, as we spoke about yesterday, is to do with tension. You know. So, when you develop that a little bit further, and you develop the plane a little bit further, I like to try and think about how you can use ornamentation and other little tricks and flicks, cording, which we'll talk about later, to create, I suppose really create phrasing within the tune. Now, we spoke about breathing yesterday as an aid to relaxation. But the banjo has no natural breath, so there's no natural pause. You could literally play five tunes in a row without ever breaking pace from so it loses all interest, it loses all dynamic, and there's no natural phrase within the instrument. If you're playing the flute, you've got to take a breath, and so the phrase is created by the instrument. The same is true with the accordion, because there's some notes in the beginning and some notes in the way out, and the same is true with a fiddle. But that's not natural on the banjo, so therefore we need to create it in an artificial way, in a sense, but we need to actually think about it and create the phrase. And the simplest way to create a phrase when you're playing is just to pause, you know, to leave the long note. For some reason, banjo players are inclined to put a treble on every single long note that they ever come across. So you can end up with a... You know, and sometimes when you see a player that are very, very tense, they put little trebles where they don't fit at all. That kind of player. Okay. So put that up against the banjo player who's playing it. Like long notes, and the banjo is like, you know, so there's this horrific clash of rhythm and phrasing. When you're traveling on a downward motion like that, it's much better if you place all three fingers on and then take them off, rather than trying to be pressing down and lifting off at the same time. Okay? So you just put on the three fingers and just put them off. Going up is easier because the string is trapped all the way. So that's your basic treble, and that's where you would be going from, for instance, a B to a D, and you'd be put in. But if you can also use a treble where it just goes from the note up a half and back down again. Traveling the B, you go. It's just a little bit softer than the treble. And for instance, on the long A, just to tap on and off the B. Can you hear where that treble is coming in? It's a little bit softer than the open, full, triplet, rather than the treble. Instead of using the C sharp, which would be the C, it would be in tune of the A, if you like, it's in the key of A. It's not playing the C naturally. We're only tuning in one every now and again. So that's, what's the name of the tune?
Mr. Clouds.
So playing it in the key of A. We'll do lots of, I'll just play for you and do lots of trebles, lots of triplets. And I'm going to throw in a C natural triplet halfway through. It just gives that a slightly different sound.
March, Gone is Welcome Home, and I use it a good bit in that.
it's smaller than the quarter note.
Sliding
C sharp and an F natural. The half note to the D and B sharp.
Thank you.
text-driven. So one of the tunes that I included, and we'll have a look at it, is Colonel Fraser. So it's a piping tune, there's plenty to it. But on one of the parts, you can do a type of chord playing that I call tapping. Okay, so I just played the part for you without it first. I think it's the third or fourth part of the tune.
Thank you.
F natural, and then resolve it back to the A. Frankie Gavin would have made that one very different, so they've done that often.
Thank you.
listen to it, and funnily enough, what comes into that as well is an almost on purpose, out of tune intonation with the left hand. If you listen to John Carty, John Carty's out of tune. In a sense that some of the high notes are actually flat, but I think that it's done on purpose because it adds to that really gorgeous off the beat, on the beat kind of fiddle playing. So the whole thing is just a little bit out of kilter, and that's what makes it so fascinating to listen to it.
Showing off.